Good morning, student. Today I am going to start chapter number 9, the Maurya Empire for 6th class, the topic of history. In this chapter, we will study about the Maurya rulers, their economic, political and social condition during that time and the Maurya administration. As we know that in the previous chapter, we have studied about the Jainism and Buddhism. The next chapter is the Maurya Empire. In this chapter, we will study about the life of Maurya rulers. So, first of all, the Maurya Empire that is established by Chandragupta Maurya, and it was the first empire in India. And Mughal Maurya gave political unity to Indians. The most important feature we can say that of the Maurya Empire is that it gave a political unity to the Indian rulers and the independent rulers. So there are different sources that gives us information about the Maurya Empire. So first one is the two books. First one that is written by Megan Thees. The first book is Indica. The first book is Indica. Sources. First one, two books. First book is Indica and second book is Arthashastra. So two books, first one is Indica that is written by Megan Thees and second one is Arthashastra that is written by Kautilya. So two books gives us important information about the political, economic and social history during the Maurya Empire. So the first one book Indica gives us information about the political and social economic conditions, and Arthashastra gives us information about the administration of the Maurya kings. So Maurya rulers was trained by a Brahmin popularly known as Kautilya. The Brahmin minister called Chanakya and called popularly known as Kautilya. He was a minister in the court of Nanda, King Dhananda. But in the Nanda court, he was greatly insulted and humiliated. So he wanted to take a revenge of his insult. So he trained a boy of Maurya and in the state affair activity and in the warfare activity. So Chandragupta Maurya, first one ruler of the Maurya Empire is Chandragupta Maurya. So Chandragupta Maurya defeated last Nanda king in 321 BC and established his rule on Magadha. So he started a Maurya Empire and Maurya foundation. So he turned his attention after that towards Punjab, and Chandragupta first liberated, got free the Punjab from Greeks. So war with Seleucus, the territory of the west of Indus was ruled by Greek king Seleucus, who was one of the Alexander general, who was a general of Alexander. So Chandragupta Maurya married his daughter and Seleucus sent a Greek ambassador Megan Thees to a Maurya court. So Seleucus, who was a general of Alexander, after defeating, he sent his Greek ambassador Megan Thees in the court of Maurya. And Megan Thees, who wrote the Indica that gives us information about the political and economic condition of Maurya Empire. So after that, he established Maurya Empire and ruled for about 25 years. So Chandragupta Maurya, he was known as a founder of Maurya Empire, and he established first independent empire in India known as a Maurya Empire, and he ruled for 25 years and he defeated the Seleucus king. The second one is the Bindusara. Bindusara, he is the son of Chandragupta Maurya, and like his father, he was very great and powerful and wise man, and he ruled for 24 years and continued his father's career of conquest and expansion, and he maintained his vast empire and extended it till Mysore. The next one is Ashoka. He is the son of Bindusara. Ashoka, also very famous and powerful Maurya king, came to power after the death of his father Bindusara in 273 BC. And he started rule from his capital Pataliputra. And when Ashoka came to power, he followed the policy of a direct conquest like his father and grandfather. He followed the policy of a direct conquest. And during this time, only Kalinga was an independent kingdom. So he invaded Kalinga in 261 BC. The most famous and most important event in the history of India, Kalinga War. So Kalinga War in 261 BC. So Ashoka invaded Kalinga in 261 BC, and the Maurya Empire, Maurya army defeated the Kalinga army. But it was a worse war. Both the army, both side army, Kalinga army and Maurya army, both suffered heavy loss. According to Ashoka's edict, 1 lakh people were killed in this war. 150,000 were taken prisoners, and this caused misery to many women and children. The death and destruction which followed the Kalinga war made Ashoka sad and happy, because in this war army suffered heavy loss. So it changed the mind of Ashoka, and it became a turning point. So Kalinga war became a turning point in his life, because he started his career by following the policy of direct conquest. But after the war of Kalinga, the sadness and misery, death and destruction that was followed during the war of Kalinga changed the life of Ashoka. And then he decided that he would not fight any more wars, and instead he would preach the people to live in a peace. So Kalinga became a part of an important part of Maurya Empire. After the Kalinga war, Ashoka replaced his policy of direct conquest into the policy of Dama. So Digvijay or policy of conquest was replaced by Dhammavijay or Dhammaghosha, means victory of Dhamma. The Dhamma is a word of Prakrit language, in the Sanskrit it means a dharma. So next one is Ashoka Dhamma. So Ashoka Dhamma, that is started by Ashoka after the war of Kalinga. Ashoka Dhamma. Ashoka Dhamma. It was started by Ashoka after the war of Kalinga. So he replaced the policy of direct conquest into the policy of Dhamma, policy of peace. So according to the Ashoka, we should follow the idols of Dhamma. Life become pure and simple without anger, means we should leave the anger, cruelty, pride and jealousy. We should be a faithful, we should try to live in a peace, in a happy environment. So main principle of the Ashoka Dhamma, the first one is non-violence. The first principle is principles of Ashoka Dhamma. The first principle is non-violence. The word non-violence means non-injury to anyone, even a small insects or ants. So people should follow the ahimsa. No animals to be slaughtered for the sacrifice. No animal sacrifice, no injury to anyone, non-violence. We should follow the policy of tolerance. The second one is respect for, the second principle is respect for parents, elders, parents, elders, and also towards servants. According to Ashoka Dhamma principle, the second principle is that we should respect the parents, elders, and we should show a kindness, mercy and sympathy towards the servants and slave people. Then third principle is a tolerance toward all religion. We should be tolerant toward all religions. So Ashoka was tolerant towards all the religion. So he also preached the people that we should respect and follow and practice all the religion. The third one is charity for poor. Charity for poor. So the fourth principle of Ashoka Dhamma is that we should give a charity to for the poor people. We should help the poor people. So Ashoka used to say, he always say that all men are my children, and he ruled his subject, his kingdom like a father. So Ashoka took a number of welfare measures for the welfare of the people. So first one, he appointed officers called Dhamma Mahamatras who propagate or who preach the principle of Dhamma among the people. He built hospitals for both men and animals. And he had a number of rest houses constructed for the benefits of the travelers. Wells were also dug in many places for providing a better water facilities. And Ashoka built good roads and planted shady trees on both sides for the comfortable journey and for the comfort of their peoples. So next one is the spread of Buddhism. So Ashoka, he followed the principle of Buddhism. So he spread the Buddhism within the India and outside the political boundaries of India. So after the Kalinga War, Ashoka devoted most of his time, energy and vast resources towards the spread of Buddhism. Because he is a follower of Buddhism, so he started after the Kalinga War, because he replaced his policy of direct conquest into the policy of Dhamma and Dharma. So he spent most of his time for spreading the Buddhism in the different part of the country, and he gave up the hunting and became a vegetarian. He spread the principle of Dhamma, the four principle of Dhamma he spread all around the world, and also engraved them on the rocks and pillars. Then he appointed special officials called Dhamma Mahamatras, whose main duty is to improve the general life of the people and to work for the welfare of people and enforce the principle of Dhamma across the country. Then he sent many missionaries to the Burma and Sri Lanka, and it was due to the Ashoka efforts Buddhism spread. In simple, we can say that he sent many missionaries and peoples across the boundaries of India to spread the Buddhism and to preach the principle of Dhamma. He also organized a third Buddhist council at Pataliputra to discuss the way of propagating the Buddhism. Then he ordered the construction of Buddhist monasteries and Buddhist temples and many stupas. The next one is the Maurya administration. The next topic is the Maurya administration, means how Maurya kings rules all over their kingdom. So first one, they divided their administration into the two level. First one at the central level and second one at the state and local level. At the central level, all the powers lies in the hand of Ashoka, because he was a main ruler of Maurya empire. So Maurya administration was headed by the kings. The first one by Chandragupta Maurya, after that Bindusara, and the third one is Ashoka. And he was assisted and helped by the council of ministers called Mantri Parishad. So at the central level, all the powers in the hand of king, means Ashoka, but he was helped and assisted by the council of ministers, and council of ministers is known as a Mantri Parishad. Important members of the council, and under the Mantri Parishad, different department was given to the different officials. So first one is a high priest. High priest, also known as a Pohuta, who managed the religious affair during the Maurya Empire. The second one is a commander-in-chief known as a Senapati, who was responsible for the state fair activities, warfare activities, for maintaining the army, troops, soldiers, and for paying the salaries to the army. The third one is a Crown Prince. Crown Prince means Juvraj, who take decisions and who help the king in all the matters of the state. The next one is a state appointed 27 superintendents known as a adhyaksh. Apart from the ministers, consular minister Ashoka appointed 27 superintendents known as adhyaksh that mostly regulates the economic and political and social activities of the state. An important administrative officials that is known as amatyas, who was responsible for spreading the principle of dhamma, they were called amatyas. And at the state and local level, four states was maintained during the Maurya Empire. And each state and four state known as the provinces, and each state and provinces was under the control of a governor. And further, four states was divided into the districts, and at the district level, number of officials were appointed by the Maurya Empire who look after the affair of a state and provinces. And under the districts, there were many number of villages, and villages officials helped the senior officers in collecting the tax and in maintaining peace and justice in the state. Apart from that, Ashoka formed a committee to administer his capital separately, and the committee was further divided into five departments, and the main functions of the committee: first one, registration of births and death; the second one, trade and commerce, to regulate the trade and commerce and to flourish the import and export in the state; the third one, collection of the tax and revenue; then protection of foreigners; then last one is inspection of the goods. So these committee, the main function of these committees to regulate the economic and social activities during the Maurya Empire. So first one is the army. Maurya maintained a huge army, and it consisted of mainly soldiers who fight on foot, that is known as infantry, cavalry, that was horses, and elephants and carrots. And there are a number of boats who looked after every wing of the army, and Senapati was main head of the army. Then second one is the spoil system under the Maurya administration. The Maurya maintained an efficient spoil system who gave a secret information to the Ashoka what is going on in the kingdom. And they kept king informed about the happenings in the kingdom. Women were also appointed as spies. Then next one is a taxation. So tax was a main source of income during the Maurya Empire. So land revenue was a main source of income, and usually it was classified into 1/4 and 1/6 of the produce was fixed as revenue. The other source of taxation were forests, mines, customs, trades, crafts, and water. And money from the taxation was used to pay the salaries for the welfare of the people. The next one is the trade. During the Maurya Empire, trade was at the large scale. It flourished at the large scale. Import and export trade was also used during that time. And the foreign trade relationship with Sri Lanka, Egypt, and Greece. The next one is society during the Maurya Empire. So Megan says, who was a Greek ambassador, he described that Pataliputra was a capital of Maurya and was a beautiful city. King lived in a royal place, palaces, and built of stone. The caste system was available prevalent during that time, and slavery was also during that time, but slaves were looked after well, but they was good treated. The next one is occupation. During the Maurya Empire, main occupation was the people was agriculture, and such a good facilities was provided for the irrigations. Farmers were also encouraged to bring more land under cultivation, and apart from the agriculture, people were also engaged in mining, carpentry, forestry, and poetry. The next one is a Maurya art. During the Maurya Empire, art and architecture. So Maurya art rose to its peak during Ashoka time because many stupas, pillars, rocks, and edicts was constructed during the Maurya Empire. So famous stupa, Sanchi stupa, is very famous, that was built during the Maurya Empire. Pillars were beautifully polished, almost like a mirror, and Ashoka edicts were inscribed on the rocks and the pillars, and most important, the Dhamma principle, the principle of Ashoka Dhamma was also engraved on the rocks and pillars. That gives us a fine example of Maurya art and architecture. The second one is a stupa, is a dome-like structure made of stone and bricks, and it contained the relics of Buddha. A Swati stupa built by Ashoka is a masterpiece of art and architecture. The most famous pillar at Sarnath, erected at Deer Park, the lion capital of Sarnath pillar is carved out of a single block of stone. And the modern India has adopted the lion capital of Sarnath as a national emblem of India. The next one is the decline of Maurya Empire at last. So, Chandragupta Maurya, who established the Maurya Empire and after that and ruled for 25 years, after that Bindusara, who ruled for 24 years, and Ashoka, the most and powerful king who defeated and invaded and captured the Kalinga, that was an independent kingdom during that time. But after the Ashoka, the Maurya kings was not able or were very weak, and they have no managerial skills how to manage the kingdom. So it become a main cause for the decline of Maurya Empire. So after the Ashoka, rulers were so weak, they could not control the empire efficiently. Then they failed to maintain huge army that is responsible for the for protecting the people and for the protection of Maurya Empire. Then the expenditure, more expenditure that was incurred on the bureaucracy, spoil system and trade. So it created a financial crisis and also became a root cause for the decline of Mughal Empire. Then Ashoka's anti-ritual and anti-sacrifice attitude also reduced the income of Brahmins, and Brahmin became against of the Ashoka. Then oppressive rule in the state was an important cause of breakup of empire. So at the last Maurya king, the last Maurya king Bhritat was killed by his own commander-in-chief Pushyamitra Sangha, and who started the Sangha dynasty in Magadha. So four to three main causes of the first one, financial crisis, then failed to maintain the army, weak Maurya rulers, and the last one, the attack of the commander-in-chief of Pushyamitra Sangha, who started the Sangha dynasty, became a cause of the cause for the decline of Maurya Empire. So coming to page number 85, the page number 85, MCQs, true false, matching the column were given. So it's your homework to read the chapter thoroughly in detail and underline the important dates and important word, and try to solve the back exercise and write down in your notebooks. So in this chapter we have studied about the Maurya rulers. Thanks and have a nice day.